that Amritsar, I will request you all to enroll for this program. It's a unique program where you have a blend of learning and also of fellowship with your seniors. So do enroll it. We have on Saturday, that is tomorrow, we have a program full day on insolvency code, which we have in really good learned speakers. And we have a panel discussion where we have a mixture of lawyers and chartered accountants who will be there. And it's a good area of practice for professionals. So yearly, and we have to clear the exam to be a IPR professional or IBC. So the exam is somewhere in the end of October. So please want to appear. This seminar will really help you how to clear those exams and solve the issues of, as far as IBC is concerned. With this, I hand over the proceedings to Rajesh. Thank you very much.
Thank you, President. Good evening, everybody. As President said, it is always our endeavor to keep on learning whatever new is happening. So on a quarterly basis where we are planning this lecture meeting, we thought let us start with the recent developments in international taxation. So we could think none other than our today's speaker, Shri Himanshu Bhai Parekh, to give an extensive talk on few case laws which he thinks these are very important in this recent development, fee structuring, how the regulatory are taking into consideration. So 4-5 good decisions which has been enforced now will be taken by our today's speaker. With this, I request our co-chairman Rajesh L. Shah to introduce the today's speaker, Shri Himanshu Bhai Parekh.
Good evening, everybody. Himanshu is a partner in KPMG International Tax and Regulatory Practice, and is also co-head in Media and Entertainment Practice. Besides being a chartered accountant, he is also a post accountant and company secretary. He has over 2 decades of professional experience on various tax and regulatory matters, also cross-border tax issues and investment structure, both inbound and outbound. He has advised multinationals on complex tax issues and helps citizens in developing appropriate strategies for tax planning and restructuring of operations. And he has mainly focused on technology, media and entertainment, and telecommunications sector. He is also a regular speaker at various forums and has contributed several articles, papers in professionals, newspapers. He has also presented papers in our international tax RRC, various papers he has presented, and he is very thorough and very firm and very lucid. And besides being professional education, as a person, he is a very humble and noble person, and he is very down to earth. So with this few words, I would request President Mr. Ajay Singh to hand over him a moment as a mark of our respect.
President Mr. Ajay Singh, Chairman Rajesh, Co-Chairman, again Rajesh. Thank you so much for this kind words of introduction. It's my pleasure to be back here at the CTC and make you a presentation on some of the recent developments in the field of international taxation. Now, if you see, over the last 1 year or so, there have been innumerable developments in the area of international tax. So for example, we've seen the amendments happening to the India, Mauritius, Singapore, Cyprus treaties. We've seen all the developments in the context of debts and how India has gone about implementing some of the OECD debts recommendations, including, for example, introduction of the equalization levy, or for example, introduction of the CBIC or master rule from a transparent perspective, introduction of the thin cap rules from interest deductibility perspective, so on and so forth. And of course, India being a signatory to the multilateral instrument of the OECD in the month of June. So we've seen all that happen over the last few months or so. Now, having said that, now, there's enough written and said about all these developments which I just referred to. Therefore, what I thought was, rather than focusing on all these aspects, let's focus on some of the recent important judicial precedents which have been rendered by courts, both in India and some case law even of overseas courts, some interesting cases which I learned from the perspective of international taxation. So with this brief background, let me straight away dive into the topic. What I've done is I've looked at some 7 or 8 important cases which courts have rendered over the past few months. Let's look at each of them and the ramifications thereof as we advise our clients in terms of international tax aspects to be watchful of from an Indian perspective. So first and foremost, let's look at the landmark decision rendered by the Supreme Court a few months back in the case of Formula One World Championships Limited, or FOWC in short. Now, as you all know, Formula One is in the business of conducting car races globally, and it's pretty well reputed and known to everybody. In this case, what happened was FOWC, which is a UK based company, it was a commercial right holder in respect of Formula One car racing. FOWC entered into an agreement known as a race promotion contract with JP Infrastructure, an Indian company, whereby it granted to JP the right to host, stage and promote the Formula One event in India. Those rights were granted for a period of 5 years, and races were actually conducted in India in the years 2011, 12 and 13. Now, the consideration for entering into this contract was split in 2 parts. The sum of $40 million which was payable by JP to Formula One for acquiring the right to host the event in India. It was JP's obligation to construct the entire racing circuit. What we mean by racing circuit is a venue where the car races take place. So JP was supposed to construct the racing circuit. And that JP was the owner of the racing circuit as well. And other than 3 weeks of the year when Formula One would be present at this event in India, so 2 weeks before the event and 1 week after the event, Formula One personnel would be present in India while conducting the races. Other than that, for the entire part of the year, the racing circuit was available to JP to carry out any other activities as it may so desire. So the consideration, as I said, was in 2 parts. One is $40 million payable by JP to Formula One for acquiring the right to host the event in India. And apart from that, $1 million payable for acquiring certain IPRs in the event, like trademarks and some other IPs. So with this factual background, Formula One made an application to the AR seeking a ruling regarding its tax implications in India. And one important point which was highlighted to the AR was that while Formula One had the right to access the venue for a period of 3 weeks every year, the actual race which was conducted in India was only for a period of 3 days in India. That's it, 3 days. So in this background, the question before the AR was regarding the tax implications of Formula One in India. The AR ruled that the amounts payable by JP to Formula One are in the nature of royalty, because these payments are made primarily with a view to acquire or exploit the IP belonging to Formula One. Now one can understand to the extent of $1 million payable goes towards some IP such as trademarks, etc. But to the extent of $40 million, it becomes very difficult to comprehend as to how can that payment be royalty, because it was merely paid to acquire a right to host the event. If you look at the definition of royalty, a payment made for merely acquiring a right to host an event cannot fit within the definition of royalty. Having said this, this is a view with the AR2 that the entire payment is in the nature of royalty. On the question whether Formula One could have a permanent establishment or PE in India, we are ruled that Formula One would not have any PE in India, because Formula One did not have any fixed place of business available at its disposal in India for that to have a fixed place PE. So on that count, it has that there is no PE in India. Not being satisfied with the ruling of AR, Formula One filed challenge the order of the AR before the Delhi High Court by way of a writ petition. And the Delhi High Court overturn the order of the AR to hold that the payment made by JP to Formula would not be in the nature of royalty. Yes, to the extent of 1 million it may be royalty, but not the balance 40 million. So that payment was made only to acquire a right to hold the event, which does not fit within the definition of royalties. However, the Delhi High Court again overturning the order of the AR held that Formula 1 had a PE in India, and that PE being in the form of a fixed place of business in India, which is a racing circuit where the car race was conducted. That was held to be a fixed place PE of Formula 1 in India by the Delhi High Court. And accordingly, it was held that since Formula 1 had a PE in India and was liable to pay taxes in India, JP was liable to withhold taxes on the payments to Formula 1 on the income attributable to the PE. Again, not being satisfied with the order of the Delhi High Court, Formula 1 challenged the verdict of the Delhi High Court before the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court in this case issued a landmark decision on this subject matter. So let's have a look at the Supreme Court decision. Before we get into what the Supreme Court held, it is important for us to look at the definition of PE. And when I talk about PE, I am talking about Article 5.1, which is fixed place PE, wherein the treaty says that an enterprise shall be deemed to have a fixed place PE in the source country if it carries on business through a fixed place of presence in the host country. So your foreign enterprise carries on business through a fixed place of business in the host country, then it will have a PE in the host country. If we break this definition into certain key elements, there are essentially four key elements of this definition. First and foremost, the foreign enterprise should have some fixed place of business in the host country. Second element, such place of business should be available at the disposal of the foreign enterprise. And what we mean by disposal is the foreign enterprise should have access to that place of business, should have control over that place of business. Some business activity should be carried out by the foreign enterprise at that fixed place of business. And fourth element, given the meaning of the word permanent establishment, there has to be some degree of permanence vis-à-vis that fixed place of business. It should not be a temporary place of business, otherwise it cannot fit within the meaning of PE. So these are the four tests to be fulfilled for a foreign enterprise to have a fixed place PE, say in India. So keeping this test in mind, let's see how did the Supreme Court go about analyzing the fulfillment of these conditions. So the Supreme Court firstly held that the racing circuit itself is a fixed place of business of Formula 1 in India. It secondly held that Formula 1 had not only got access to that racing circuit, but it had complete control over the racing circuit for a period of those 3 weeks when races were conducted in India. While Formula 1 had only granted the right to JP to host the event, and ideally speaking, JP should have the right to do whatever it wanted during those 3 weeks period when the races were conducted. The matter of fact was, Formula 1 had sent its own personnel to India. They would decide as to who can enter the racing circuit, who cannot enter the racing circuit, what is the activity which can be done there, what cannot be done there, and they were completely monitoring and supervising the conducting of the races. And JP was under the direct supervision and control of the personnel of Formula 1 when the races were conducted in India. So the Supreme Court came to a conclusion that Formula 1 had control over the racing circuit for a period of those 3 weeks. And therefore it held that place of disposal test, which we spoke about, is also fulfilled in this case, that this racing circuit is at the disposal of Formula 1. In terms of the duration test or permanence test, the Supreme Court held that the fact that the event took place only for 3 days, or the fact that Formula 1 had a presence in India only for 3 weeks, which is 2 weeks before the event and 1 week after the event, that is good enough to satisfy the permanence criteria. And we may find this to be a little strange that in the context of fixed place PE, where the OECD commentary primarily says that a fixed place PE can generally arise if the foreign enterprise has a presence of about 6 months in the host country, how can a 3 weeks presence ever result in a fixed place P. There are two reasons why the Supreme Court came to this conclusion. And while coming to this conclusion, the Supreme Court extensively referred to various commentaries on the OECD and various points of view. We should look at the OECD commentary also, what it says in that regard. So the Supreme Court laid emphasis on two points. Point number one, it said that while those personnel of Formula One had presence in India only for 3 weeks, they had presence during the entire duration of the event in India. The event itself was for 3 weeks, and for the entire duration, they were allowed to have this, you know, they were allowed to have control over the racing circuit, number one. Number two, the Supreme Court observed by reproducing the order of the Delhi High Court, with which it agreed to say that, don't look at this as a one-off event. This is a case where Formula One has granted rights to JP for 5 years. And therefore, the presence has to be looked at from a 5-year horizon, not just as a one-off event. So keeping these two criteria in mind, number one, the presence being there for the entire duration of the event, and number two, because this agreement was for 5 years, and Formula One would have a right to access as well as control over this venue for 5 years, the Supreme Court held that the permanence test was also fulfilled in this case. Let us see how do these observations or conclusion of the Supreme Court, how does it compare with what the OECD has to say on the matter? So let's look at the observations of the OECD on this. On the aspect of fulfillment of permanence test. So the OECD commentary says that a P can be deemed to exist only if the place of business has a certain degree of permanency. That is, if it is not of a purely temporary nature. It further says that experience has shown that P's normally have not been considered to exist in situations where a business had been carried on in a country through a place of business that was maintained for less than 6 months. So this is a general criteria of 6 months, that normally speaking of this place, P will not arrive unless the presence is for 6 months in India. But it further says that a place of business may however constitute a P, even though it exists in practice only for a very short period of time, because the nature of the business is such that it will only be carried out for that short period of time. And look at the last point, where a particular place of business is used for only very short periods of time, but such usage takes place regularly over long periods of time, the place of business should not be considered to be of purely temporary nature. So the Supreme Court also got guided by this point number 3 and 4 of the OECD commentary, and also the commentaries of several other authors to say that, while normally speaking, yes, 6 months should be the criteria for office space P2 rise. In this case, because of whatever I read in bullet number 3 and 4, it would result in the permanence test being fulfilled, and therefore Formula 1 having a fixed place P in India. There is one more important aspect of this entire ruling, and that is that when the Supreme Court analyzed the facts of this case, it observed that not only did Formula One have a contract with JP for conducting the races in India, there were multiple other contracts between affiliates of Formula One and JP, everything in the context of holding these races in India. And the Supreme Court says that one is to take a holistic approach, not look at agreements in silos, look at the activities being conducted or contracts being entered into by all the group entities put together with JP. Look at the presence of the entire group as a whole in India, not by just one legal entity within the group. And if you look at it in a holistic manner, it was very clear that JP, along with its affiliates, was responsible for conducting races in India, and it had a complete control over the venue in India, and therefore it did result in a PE of Formula One in India. So the Supreme Court held that Formula One did have a PE in India. On the point as to what should be the amount of profits liable to tax in India, the Supreme Court, referring to Article 7, said that there is only so much profits of Formula 1 which should be attributable to the activities of P, which can be subject matter of taxation. And for determining what profit would be attributable to P, it restored the matter back to the assessing officer to adjudicate them. And finally, it held that because Formula 1 did have a P in India and was liable to tax in India, payments made by JP to Formula 1 were subject to withholding tax in India under Section 195. So So this is what the Supreme Court had to hold in this case. In the peculiar facts of this case, the presence in India for a limited period of 3 weeks was held to result in a fixed place in India. Let us look at some of the ramifications of this decision in the next slide. Two very important aspects that I would like to emphasize here. One is this entire concept of group B. While if you get the bare language of Article 5, there is no concept of a group B, except if you look at agency P article, in some cases, in the context of agency P article, the treaty does say that you need to see that if the agent carries out activities for a principal and its affiliates. But in fixed place P, there is no concept of group B. So the Supreme Court went one step further here to say that not only will we look at the activities of Formula 1, but activities of Formula 1 plus its affiliates put together. That's something which needs to be emphasized, and going forward we need to be very, very careful that in cases where multinational companies split a particular contract into different elements and get different elements of contract getting executed by different group companies, now there's a risk of the tax authorities looking at activities of all the group companies put together relying on the Supreme Court decision. That's point number one. The second thing is, how is the tax office now likely to look at this entire aspect of fixed place fee? It is quite possible that the tax office will say in each and every case, wherever there is a presence of a few days in India of an overseas entity, it should now result in a fixed place fee. Or if a 3 weeks presence in India can lead to a fixed place fee, then even 1 week presence can lead to a fixed place fee, or 1 month presence can lead to a fixed place fee. And the question is, this entire 6 month criteria, which is an indicative criteria in the OECD community, does it go for a toss? Is that concept entirely violated by the Supreme Court? In my view, answer is no. I would say the 6 month criteria does not go for a toss. The general principle still will be to examine it from the perspective of 6 month criteria. It is only in some peculiar cases like this, where a contract may be over a term of 5 years, and where the presence being in India for the entire duration of the event. So the principle from this decision should be restricted only to such cases where the non-resident has presence for the entire duration of the event, and that event itself has been carried out over more than 1 year. In such cases, the fixed place fee criteria at all can be said to be fulfilled. Not in every case where somebody has a limited presence in India should be realized in a fixed place fee. Having said which, it is very likely that the revenue authorities will just make use of the decision and go tangling bonds after all taxpayers to say that a fixed PSP arises the moment there is a physical presence in India. Yes, sir.
If the contract was for 1 year, F1 and JP, would that situation be different?
I would think so. Perhaps the answer would have been different because a lot of emphasis was laid by the Delhi High Court on this aspect of the contract being for 5 years and then the activity being carried out over 5 years, and which the Supreme Court has sort of emphasized that aspect in its decision also. Possibly the answer could have been different had it been only a 1 year contract and the activity being carried out in India being restricted to 3 weeks.
The 6 month criteria has been extended because of the 5 year duration.
5 year duration.
1 year, maybe 6 months would have been fulfilled. Maybe because the entire F1 activity was there for a couple of weeks.
3 weeks.
3 weeks, it says. Yeah. So the 6 month criteria would not have been fulfilled.
So therefore, it would not be.
Yes, therefore, it would be a good case to argue that it should not have been. In fact, there was one of the points which Formula 1 took up before the Supreme Court. And I was talking to a counsel who represented Formula 1 before the Supreme Court, and he said that one of the pleas which they took before the Supreme Court is that Formula 1 has been conducting these races globally since last so many years. And there is not a single country in the world which is alleged that Formula 1 has a P in that country. It is only India which is alleged, made this allegation of there being a P. No other country does Formula 1 pay any taxes on the ground as a P. But that also argument was not. Obviously, the Supreme Court would go by the language of the treaty, not the fact that no other country has alleged to be P. Okay, so much so about the Supreme Court decision in the case of Formula 1. Let us now go to a very, very interesting decision of the Bangalore tribunal in the case of ABBXZ LLC. Wherein the Bangalore tribunal has given a somewhat totally new dimension to the concept of service fee and also the aspect of taxation of royalty. Let's first look at the facts of this case. This is a case where ABBXZ LLC, the assessee in short, is a UAE-based company. The company is engaged in the business of providing regional support services to its group entities in India, Middle East and Africa. The SEC in this case entered into an agreement with ABB India to provide certain support services. There are four categories of support services to be provided by the SEC to ABB India. The first one was in the area of occupational health and safety services, OHS services in short. The second one was assistance in the area of security services. Third one was in the area of risk management services. And the fourth one was in the area of market development services. If you look at the further elements of each of these services, coming to OHS services, the SSE was supposed to conduct OHS audits of the operations of the Indian affiliate. It was also responsible for coaching and monitoring the OHS advisors of ABB in India in implementing and developing OHS strategies and plans. As far as security services are concerned, the SSE was responsible for providing crisis training to the people in India and also providing training for security awareness. As far as project risk management services are concerned, again, the SSE was responsible for providing risk management training to personnel of India and also sharing some best practices which occur globally within the group. As far as market development services are concerned, the SSE was responsible for assisting people in India for development of business plans and also assistance in development of plan on how to become more competitive in the marketplace. So essentially if you see, by and large these are in the nature of support services, which typically in the case of any MNC you will find that most of these MNCs provide such kind of support services to their group entities worldwide and then recover a portion of the cost from each of the group entities worldwide. Now, the manner in which these services were provided, the SSE clarified before the tribunal that the services were primarily provided over emails and phone calls and also by way of some personnel visiting India. However, in this case, the visit of those personnel, and there were only three personnel who visited India, and that too only for a period of 25 days. So only three people came to India for 25 days. Rest, all the services were provided over emails and phone calls. Now, the contention that the SSE took up in this case before the lower authorities and thereafter before the tribunal was that the income which arises to it is from provision of services. As far as the India-UAE treaty is concerned, the SSE was from UAE, there is no FTS article under the India-UAE treaty. So the SSE argued that its income should therefore be governed by the other income article of the treaty. Under the other income article, other income would be taxable only in the state of residence, which is UAE in this case, except if the UAE entity providing the services has a PE in India. And the SSE argued that it did not have any PE in India because the limited presence of three people in India for 25 days does not create its PE in India, and therefore in the absence of PE, this income should not be taxable in India. It also relied on a tribunal order in its own case for one of the areas where the tribunal held so. The SSE does not have PE in India and this income should be taxed as per the income article, and as per the income article, only UAE is allowed to tax this income. And it also relied on a few other cases on the subject matter. Let's see what is the position with the assessing officer in this case. So the AO held that in the absence of FTA's article under the India UAE treaty, one should look at the FTA's article under the Indian Income Tax Act, so section 917 of the Act. And therefore these services were so wide in nature so as to fit within the definition of FTA's under section 917. And then the AO very surprisingly held that alternatively, if that view is not upheld, alternatively this income should be taxed as royalty. And why royalty? Because if we see one of the elements of definition of royalty in the treaty, it says that where any consideration is paid for availing any information concerning any industrial, commercial or scientific experience, payment for such information tantamount to royalty. Now the matter of fact is either a payment can be for availing some services or the payment can be for royalty. How can it be either or royalty or FTS? So either the officer should have said this payment is for services and because of FTS article not being there in treaty, I'll go back and tax it under the Act. or he should have stated these tax sellers were empty. He could not have said either tax sellers empty, yes or not, even both are mutually exclusive. Be that as it may be, this is what the officer had. Let us see what the tribunal had to say in this matter. So the tribunal first examined whether the assessee could have a service fee in India. So before we go to the observations of the tribunal, let us look at the service fee article of the India-UAE treaty. The service fee article is contained in Article 5-I of the treaty. Let us read out the limits. Let us say that the term P includes especially the furnishing of services, including consultancy services by an enterprise of a contracting state through employees or other personnel in the other contracting state, provided such activities continue for the same project or connected project for a period or periods aggregating more than 9 months within any 12-month period. So essentially it says that where a UAE-based entity provides any services to somebody in India, somebody in India, for a period of more than 9 months within a 12-month period, it can result in a service fee. This is a simple language of service fee article. Now let's see how the tribunal interpret this clause. Let's go back to the observations of the tribunal. So the tribunal in this case observed that in the present age of technology, it is not necessary for somebody to provide services by physically sending people to India. And services can be provided electronically or through virtual modes like emails, telephone calls, so on and so forth. In the way the tribunal read the service fee article is to say that, according to the tribunal, it is the rendering of the services for more than 9 months which is relevant, irrespective of the place where the services are rendered. So the tribunal held that even if the services were primarily rendered from overseas, given that the services were rendered for more than 9 months, and the presence in India may only be for 25 days, that is irrelevant for service fee to arise. We further made an observation to say that for the purpose of Article 5.2, one does not have to fulfill the test of Article 5.1, which is that the non-resident may not have a fixed place of business in India for a service fee to arise. The fact that service has been rendered is good enough for a service fee to arise. And accordingly, finally the tribunal held that the assessee had a service fee in India. Now, there are multiple issues which arise as a result of, if I may say, this weird interpretation of the tribunal. Firstly, this interpretation of the tribunal goes squarely against the plain and unambiguous language of the article. The language is very, very clear to say that if services are rendered in India for more than 9 months, then it leads to a service fee. And the way tribunal reads it to say that if services are rendered for more than 9 months, it leads to a service fee. So it ignores the words in the other contracting state. That's point number one. If you take this interpretation of the tribunal forward, it will again lead to a weird situation. Now, in the India-UAE treaty, there was no FTS article. But assume that there was an FTS article in the India-UAE treaty. So as per the tribunal, even if the services were rendered from UAE, it leads to a service fee. And had there been an FTS article, it would perhaps also be taxable under an FTS article. So now, which of the two articles will the income finally be taxable? The simple interpretation of law is that if services have been rendered from overseas and if they fulfill the definition of FTS, then this FTS article which becomes applicable. Whereas if services are rendered from India or in India, and if you cross the number of threshold days during the service fee article, the service fee article is triggered. But to take a view that even if services are rendered from overseas, it results in a service fee, it will be in direct conflict with the FTS article. The fact that for a service fee to arise, people have to necessarily be present in India for the number of days prescribed in the service fee article is something which has been held time and again by various courts, including by the Supreme Court. So we have the Supreme Court decision in the case of Morgan Stanley, we have the Delhi High Court decision in the case of E-Front, we have the Mumbai Tribunal in the case of Reuters. There are so many other decisions which have categorically held that for a service fee to arise in India, the overseas entity needs to have physical presence in India for entering the services. Only then can a service fee arise in India. Let us look at the observations of some of these decisions. at the observations of Supreme Court in modern standard. It says that Article 5-2N, which is the service pay article, applies in cases where the multinational enterprise furnishes services within India and those services are furnished to its employees. Let's look at E-funds. Suppose L requires furnishing of services within the second contracting state by a foreign enterprise through its employees or their personnel. Suppose L would apply only if the foreign enterprise or the two associates had performed services in India through their employees or personnel. So very, very clear that for a service fee to arise, services have to be rendered in India for those particular number of days, whatever be the threshold prescribed in the treaty. If services are rendered from overseas, it cannot result in a service fee in India. And again, if you take this view, that if services are rendered from overseas and it can still lead to a service fee, no, that would actually make the concept of service fee wider than the concept of business connection as well. And the assessing will be better off relying on the provisions of the Act rather than the treaty. So when you look at the concept of business connection also, explanation to 911 categorically says that even when a non-resident has business connection in India, it is only so much of the income which is attributable to the operations carried out in India which can be taxed in India. So I would rather rely on business connection rather than go by the treaty, right? Because I will be better off on that. And clearly therefore the intention of the treaty was not to give this interpretation to service fee. And clearly therefore the tribunal seems to have called while coming to this conclusion that the SSE has service fee in India. So just again to give you, you know, share with you some of the Supreme Court decisions in the context of business connection. Let's look at the landmark decision of Supreme Court in the case of RD Agarwal, where it says that a business connection in section 42 of the 1922 Act involves a relation between a business carried on by a non-resident which yields profits or gains and some activity in the taxable countries, which is India, which contributes directly or indirectly to the earning of those profits or gains. Similarly, has been taken by the Supreme Court in Tushu and Carbondale company as well. And therefore, the tribunal clearly seems to have called here by holding that the SSE had a service fee in India. But the tribunal was not satisfied after holding that to be a service fee. It further went to examine whether the income of the SSE can also be taxed as royalty. And again, a weird situation. If the income is taxable as service fee, where is the question of then going into examination of royalty? But the tribunal first went further to say as to whether this income can also be taxed as royalty. Let's see what the tribunal had to say in that context. So, we referred to the clauses of the agreement earlier, which very clearly were in the nature of support services provided by the SSE to ABB in India. But the way that tribunal read the agreement was slightly different, and tribunal just picked and chose some of the clauses of the agreement which would give it an impression of ABB, the SSE, rendering some specialized knowledge, skill and experience and sharing it with the SSE with ABB in India. So the tribunal observed that in terms of the contract, the assessee was responsible for provision of information as well as providing assistance in development of strategies, goals and instructions in the field of occupational health and safety. It further observed that the assessee was responsible for coaching of the OHS advisors in the implementation of any health related procedure. It further observed that as per the agreement, the assessee was responsible for development of business for conversion of waste heat into power, also responsible for providing assistance to account managers in India with respect to preparation of yearly account plans and assistance in setting up their sales targets. In the way the tribunal interpreted all these clauses is to say that, in essence, the assessee basically was providing information to ABB in India. What kind of information was this? Information in the nature of special knowledge, skill and experience which the SSE had. It was sharing that specialized skill, knowledge and experience with ABB in India by providing these services. Rather further observed that this information which was shared by the SSE with ABB, this information was not available in public domain and was in the nature of some know-how which the SSE shared with ABB in India. And that the SSE primarily gave access to the secret and confidential know-how IP which it had to ABB in India. And very surprisingly enough, here the tribunal observed that this is not a case of rendering of services by the SSE to ABB in India. because rendering of services were primarily required. Personnel to be sent to India to render services to ABB in India. And said that in this case, the visit of the personnel was only for a period of 25 days. There was a very, very limited presence in India. And that visit was only for providing access to the information to ABB in India. As we saw earlier, in the context of service fee, tribunal held that this is a case of rendering of services, and it results in a service fee. And in the context of royalty, the tribunal observes that this is not a case of rendering services. This is a case of provision of some secret know-how, information, experience, skill, know-how. So, in the same order, at one place it says this is a case of rendering services, and another place it says this is not a case of rendering services. Again, in the context of service fee, we saw the tribunal says that service need not be necessarily rendered in India. Services can be rendered over email, over phone calls. In today's virtual world, there is no need for anybody to travel to India. In the context of world, it says that for services to be rendered in India, obviously people will have to travel to India. Therefore, this is not a case of rendering services. So the tribunal contradicts itself at enough and more places in the decision. And having contradicted itself, it came to a conclusion that the payment is also in the nature of royalty. And finally, in what manner is the income to be taxed in India? Is it to be taxed under service fee on a net income basis? Or is it to be taxed as royalty on a gross basis? That is something the tribunal has not touched upon at all. It ended what it was saying, yes, thus is a service fee in India, and also that the income is in the nature of royalty. Only God knows how will the officer finally determine the manner of taxing this income in India. From this entire aspect of royalty, and this expression, information concerning industrial promotion and scientific experience. Let us look at what the OECD has to say on the matter. What exactly falls within the purview of this expression, information concerning industrial promotion and scientific experience? So we see the OECD commentary on this aspect. OECD says that providing information concerning ICS meaning information concerning industrial promotion or scientific experience, refers to supply of know-how by one party to the other party. So if we further observe that in a know-how contract, one party imparts information which is in the nature of specialized knowledge and experience to the other party to enable the other party to utilize this know-how for its own use. What kind of information falls within the purview of this definition? It is only undivulged or secret information which is available to the person rendering the services. And which information arises from previous experience? This is important. Information arising from previous experience. So if somebody has already derived some special knowledge, skill, experience over a number of years, and that is imparted to somebody else, that's a case of provision of information concerning industrial promotion and scientific experience. But if somebody is going to be engaged by a particular party to say, please conduct so and so research for me, and after conducting this research, please provide so and so information to me, that is not a case of sharing previous experience. Because now you are going to conduct special research, you are going to derive information which you will now supply. That is a case of rendering services, not a supply of knowledge. So the OECD distinguishes between the two. And the OECD clearly distinguishes between a contract involving supply of know-how and provision of services. In this connection, the OECD clarifies that know-how contracts primarily concern information that already exists and not some new information which has to be developed. And generally speaking, these contracts provide for confidentiality of the information. Whereas contracts involving provision of services envisage that while the service provider may use his special skills, knowledge and experience available to provide service to the service recipient, that skill, experience or knowledge is not actually imparted to the service recipient. And further observe that rendering of services would generally involve incurring of some expenditure by the service provider. What kind of expenditure? Expenditure in the form of recruiting people, office expenditure, administrative expenditure, etc. So those people will then render services. But in the case of imparting know-how, you already have know-how available with you. You will just impart it to somebody else and you don't require to incur any significant expenditures. So this is the basis on which the OECD distinguishes between a contract of know-how any market for Indigo services?
But the SSC in his own case had a precedent. On different tax. And Morgan Stanley was pressed into service during the year.
So SSC did have its own decision point in earlier year. And then Triangle brushed aside that decision of earlier on 2-3 counts. Number one said, the Triangle said, in the earlier year's order, the Triangle has not examined whether the SSC is a service fee in India. And the tribunal in the earlier year has paid one to other income article whether without examining as to whether this income can mount to royalty. So on those counts, we are not following the earlier year because all those aspects have not been examined by the tribunal.
Ajay, in such a scenario,
according to bench cannot overrule the order of according to bench. They should have
For not following Morgan Stanley, this can even be rectified.
Yeah, absolutely. These are things I'm sure the SSC might be contemplating by you anyway.
Rectification seems to be difficult. Because here it involves again a lot of arguments are there, new points are there. So really rectification
is...
But judicial precedent has been violated. To that extent, you can always...
It is not coming out from the decision whether the associate relied on Morgan Stanley in this case. It is not coming out from the decision. What does come out from the decision is some case laws related in the context of royalty. In those cases, the tribunal was able to distinguish on facts.
No, because the Morgan Stanley clearly says that the services should be rendered in the country. And the article also clearly says so. Whether Morgan Stanley was relied upon or not relied upon, that is a Supreme Court decision available in the public domain. And the wordings of article are also very clear. So even from that point of view, one must not say this is an apparent mistake.
One can explore the provisions.
So clearly, in this case, the way I look at it, this was a case of provision of support services by the SSC to ABB in India. So this was a case of rendering of services. This was not a case involving payment of royalty for provision of any secret information or know-how. And in this case, to my mind, the tribunal did earn, including the SSC and the service fee in India, the correct view should have been that the income falls within the other income article, and in the absence of fee in India, the income should not have been taxable in India. Let's move on to the next decision, which is in the context of agency pay. Let's look at the facts of this case. This is a case involving a Star TV Group company by the name of International Global Networks BV or IGN BV in short. So let's look at the entities involved in this case. So right at the top we have Star TV Limited, which is an entity set up outside India and which is the owner of Star TV channels. Star TV Limited in turn owns Star Hong Kong, to whom it has given the right to sell its advertising inventory. Star Hong Kong in turn owns the SSC, IGN BV. Star Hong Kong had in turn given the right to sell the advertising inventory of the TV channels to the SSC. And the SSC in turn appointed an ad sales agent in India, which is again Star India Private Limited or SIP in short, whereby it appointed Star India to procure business from advertisers in India on a commission at the rate of 15% of ad revenues. The role or job of SIPL was to solicit advertisements at rates to be fixed by the SSC, and it was for the SSC to decide whether to accept particular advertisements or reject them. The rates of the advertisement were also fixed by the SSC or other Star TV. The question before the tribunal was whether the SSC is liable to tax in India or not. So, before we get into what the tribunal held, let's look at the agency fee article of the India Netherlands Treaty, which was learned in this case. So, if you look at Article 5.5 of the treaty, 5.5 and 5.6 basically deal with agency fee clause. Article 5.5 says that notwithstanding the provisions of para 1 and 2, where a person other than an agent of an independent state as to whom para 6 applies is acting in one of the states on behalf of the enterprise of the other state, that enterprise shall be deemed to have a P in the first mentioned state if he has and eventually exercises in that state and authority to contribute Congress on behalf of the enterprise. I will not read the balance portion, it is not true. But let's look at 5-6, which is very important in our case. It says that an enterprise of one of the states shall not be deemed to have a P in the other state merely because it carries on business in that other state through a broker, a general commission agent, or any other agent of an independent status, provided that such persons are acting in the ordinary course of that business. However, when the activities of such an agent are devoted fully or almost fully on behalf of that enterprise, he will not be considered an agent of an independent status within the meaning of this para. If it is shown that the transaction between the agent and the enterprise were not made for the absolute conditions. So essentially, for agency P test to be fulfilled, there are three conditions to be fulfilled. Point number one, the foreign enterprise should operate through an agent in India. Point number two, that agent should not be an independent agent, meaning it should be a dependent agent. And point number three, such an agent should have and should habitually exercise in India and authority to conclude contracts on behalf of the foreign enterprise. Now let's come to the facts of this case and see what the tribunal had to hold in this case. On the first aspect, it was quite clear that the SSC had appointed Star India as an agent, so the first condition was fulfilled. On the second aspect, as to whether Star India was a dependent agent or independent agent of the SSC, the tribunal observed that Star India was not only acting as an agent of the SSC, it was also acting as an agent of NGC Group of Channels. So it should be borne in mind that NGC Group is also part of the Star Group itself. It was acting as an agent for the same group of entities. Apart from that, it observed that Star India was procuring TV programs and supplying it to TV channels, and was also acting as a distributor of the TV channels of various channel companies to cable operators in India. So it was doing three activities. Number one, acting as an ad sales agent for Star and NGC. Number two, procuring and supplying TV programs. And number three, acting as a distributor or licensee of the TV channels to cable operators in India. And the tribunal further observed that if you look at the revenue which Star India derives from the assessee vis-a-vis the agency function, that is not very, very clearly coming out from the decision, it appears that the reference is only to the agency function. The tribunal observed that the assessee was earning anywhere between 0.003% of its revenues to 13.59% of revenues vis-a-vis the agency function from the assessee. And in that sense, Star India was not dependent for its survival on the assessee because the revenues were only in the range of 0.003 to 13%. And therefore, it was an independent agent of the SSC, and therefore, the SSC did not have a P in India. Now, there are some interesting points which arise from these observations of the tribunal. The first point which we need to discuss and debate is, for determining independence of an agent, are we only supposed to look at the agency function of the agent, or are we supposed to look at all the business activities of the agent put together? So let me give you an example. Say there is an agent in India which acts only for one overseas principal. Okay. And let's say it earns a revenue of 100 from the overseas principal. But the agent has some other businesses of its own. Totally distinct businesses, nothing to do with this agency business. And let's say from those other businesses, it earns revenues of 400. So the overall revenue of the agent is 500. 100 from this overseas principal from agency function. 400 from all other businesses put together. So for determining whether this agent is dependent or not, do we look at only the agency function and say that the entire 100 of revenues vis-a-vis the agency function is coming from the foreign principal and therefore it is a dependent agent? Or do we say that we have to look at it in a holistic manner and say that from an overall perspective, the overall revenues of the agent are 500, it is earning only 100 from one principal, only 20% of revenues, and therefore it is not dependent on the foreign principal. Now, we have differing sets of views on this in India. So, we have the Delhi tribunal in the case of Western Union as well as in the case of Nitin Delhi and the Mumbai Tribunal in the case of before you in an Indian holdings, wherein the tribunal has taken the view that you essentially need to look at all the businesses of the agent put together and then see as to whether the agent is dependent for its survival on the foreign principal or not. And in this example, therefore, the agent could earn only 20% of its revenues from the foreign principal. It cannot become, we say, to be a dependent agent. However, the same Delhi tribunal, in a later decision in the case of Galileo, has taken a contrary view. There it has taken a view that you only look at the agency function. And vis-a-vis the agency function, if you are completely dependent only on one principal, then you will be treated as a dependent agent. And in fact, a similar view has been taken by the OECD in the recent BEPS report, which it has come out with. It's very important to look at the observations of the OECD and discuss and debate as to which of the two views is the better view. Let's look at the observation of the OECD in this field. Incidentally, the OECD takes the second view, and it says that you only look at the agency business, and vis-a-vis the agency business, if you are earning your income only from one principal, or primarily earning most of your income only from one principal, then the agent should be regarded as a dependent agent. And why does the OECD say so? Let's read through its observations. So in the next report, OECD says that an independent agent cannot be said to act in the ordinary course of its business as such. As such meaning the agency business. So an independent agent cannot be said to act in the ordinary course of his business as such when it performs activities that are unrelated to the business of an agent. So they are saying you look at the agency business and then see whether the agent is dependent or independent. It says, and then it further says, whether, for example, a company that acts as a distributor for a number of companies to which it is not closely related also acts as an agent for a closely related enterprise, the activities that the company undertakes as a distributor will not be considered to be a part of the activities that the company carries on in the ordinary course of business as an agent, and will therefore not be relevant in determining whether the company is independent from the closely related enterprise on behalf of which it is acting. So the reason OECD comes to this conclusion is to say that you have to look at the business of the agent as such, meaning the agency business, and vis-a-vis that business, whether it is dependent or independent. And why does the OECD say so? Let's once again look at, let's once again look at the wordings of the wordings of the agency pay anti-corruption in the case where. Let's look at para 5-6. It says that an enterprise of one of the states shall not be deemed to have pay in the other state merely because it carries on business in the other state through a broker, a general commission agent, or any other agent of an independent status, provided that such persons are acting in the ordinary course of their business as such. Are the words missing here, but that's the way the OECD reads it. And therefore, the OECD says that vis-a-vis agency business are dependent or not. But I have one problem with the view of OECD here. Again, let's take an example, the same situation, where I'm acting as an agent only for one principal, but I have some other businesses of my own. Now, as per the first sentence, the foreign enterprise will not have an agency fee in India if the agent is an independent agent. As per the OECD, for determining independence, I have to look at only the agency function. If I look only at the agency function, then I am working only for one principal. And therefore, I cannot be independent agent at all because I am earning my entire revenue from one single principal. If that be the case, then under the first sentence, I will be a dependent agent, I will never be an independent agent. But now let's look at the second sentence. And the question which arises is, what is the need for that second sentence in para 5-6? which clarifies that, however, when the activities of such an agent means independent agent, however, when the activities of such an agent are devoted wholly or almost wholly on behalf of that enterprise, he will not be considered an agent of an independent status. I'll just stop there. So, it says that even if you are acting as an agent only for one principal, and if you are an independent agent under the first sentence, you will not be deemed to be independent because of the second sentence, because you are acting only for one principal. But how can I ever be an independent agent under the first sentence if I am acting only for one principal, and if I am supposed to test my independence only vis-a-vis the agency business? And therefore, to my mind, and make note of this, while the second sentence is not there in the OECD model convention, pursuant to the Webb's recommendation, the OECD itself has recommended now insertion of the second sentence in all the treaties by virtue of MLA. So the second sentence will now feature in the OECD model convention also. And therefore, the only meaningful way to read the first and second sentence together is to say that, in terms of the first sentence, I look at all the businesses of the assessor put together, come to a conclusion that yes, I am independent, because vis-a-vis my agency business, I am earning only 20% revenues from single business. But then by virtue of second sentence, I be characterized as a dependent agent because I am acting only for a single business. So coming back to the facts of this case, the tribunal took a view that because the assessor was earning only anywhere between 0.03% of its revenues, 13.59% of its revenues from the overseas principal, it was not a dependent agent, it was an independent agent, and therefore there is no PE of the assessee in India. The tribunal further went on to examine one more aspect, that even assuming if there was to be a PE in India, the matter of fact is that the assessee has paid an arm's length commission for remuneration to Star India, which is at 15% of taxes. And because an arm's length remuneration has been paid, relying on the Bombay High Court decision in the case of Seth Satellite Singapore and Delhi High Court decision in the case of BBC Worldwide, the tribunal came to a conclusion that payment of an arm's length remuneration to the agent in India, for whatever functions are carried out in India, it extinguishes the tax liability of the foreign principal in India. Now, of course, this will again is at variance with the view of the OECD. The OECD very clearly says that in the context of agency PE, it is the functions of the agent which results in a notional PE for the foreign enterprise in India. And one needs to do a functional ascertain risk analysis of the PE to ascertain the profits attributable to PE. And while arriving at the profits attributable to PE, one can claim a deduction of the commission or remuneration paid to the agent. But it is not necessary that in each and every case, just because an arm's length remuneration has been paid to the agent, that they can't get any further attributable profits to the PE.
So this concept was there even in the 1969 circular also.
Correct. That's what which was, that is what was related in the case of Seth Satellite Singapore. This is important. Now this, the revenue has challenged the decisions of the Bombay High Court and Delhi High Court before the Supreme Court. So let's see what does the Supreme Court hold on this matter. So if you see the Morgan Stanley decision and you write, said Satellite, it was itself relied on Morgan Stanley. You know, very surprisingly, if you see that pair of Morgan Stanley, there are some favorable observations which have been picked up and relied in the Bombay Court. But immediately after that, there is one more sentence which presumably goes against this information, which has not been referred to at all by the Bombay Court. Unfortunately, I don't have a decision in front of me. But if you read the entire pair of Supreme Court, when the first sentence says, gives an impression as if paying an arm's length remuneration to be an agent extinguishes the liability, then there is a further passage in the decision. It has not been verified by the Bombay Court.
So I think it says that the FAR has been determined.
Yeah,
price has been determined considering the PE.
No, but actually, if you see the last paragraph of Morgan Stanley, it says that the function analysis has been done, the remuneration has been paid, which is in consonance with that. Yes. There can't be any further
But functional analysis of whom? Of the PE, Bombay High Court says of the agent. Bombay High Court has done a functional analysis of the agent and said because the agent has been paid after the extinction. Whereas perhaps what the Supreme Court had in mind is the functional analysis of the PE, not of the agent. That is where there is a
agent. So I was coming to that.
So we can discuss that maybe after this.
Before you international, they have also considered that arm length issue.
Yeah, they also
and this has been approved by the Bombay High Court.
Correct.
and SLP is granted.
Correct. Okay, so let's proceed further now. So much so about the decision of IGNB. Let us now look at a couple of interesting foreign case laws. These are both case laws or other rulings issued by the tax board in Denmark. So the first decision is in the context of an Austrian company which had constructed a building in Denmark, and the income which it arose from constructing the building was subjected to tax in Denmark. After the building was constructed, the Austrian company and the Danish company entered into one more contract known as a service contract for a period of 10 years for servicing of the building. And what do we mean by servicing of the building? It's basically cleaning and maintenance of the building and carrying out the day-to-day operations in the building. For which purpose? The Austrian company subcontracted that entire work under the service contract to a foreign subcontractor. And no activity whatsoever pertaining to the service contract was carried out by the Austrian company in this regard. And the question was, can the Austrian company be said to have a P in Denmark having regard to the facts of the case? So the contention of the Austrian company before the Danish authorities was that while under the contract with the Danish company, it was provided certain space at its disposal for conducting the cleaning activities. The matter of fact is that it has subcontracted the entire activity to a third party, and no personnel of the Austrian company was ever going to visit Denmark for carrying out this activity. And in the absence of anybody actually visiting Denmark from the Austrian company, it cannot have a PE in Denmark. That was the position it took. Let's see what the Danish board had to hold in this regard. So the Danish board observed that as per the contract between the Austrian and the Danish company, the Danish company was supposed to make available office premises to the Austrian company for carrying out the cleaning services, and therefore the Austrian company had place available at its disposal. It further observed that the Austrian company was entitled to transfer its rights and obligations under the contract to a third party based on a written acceptance of the Danish company. Thereafter, the tax board observed that in terms of the contract between the Austrian and the Danish company, the Austrian company would have a place of business in Denmark at its disposal because the contract specifically provided that this place could be made available to the Austrian company for carrying out the cleaning services. It further observed that it was the Austrian company who was responsible for the execution of work to the Danish company, and by just subcontracting the work, the responsibility was not given away to the subcontractor, the responsibility still remained with the Austrian company. And thirdly, it observed that whatever activity was actually done by the subcontractor, it was nothing but carrying out the Austrian company's business by the subcontractor in Denmark, and therefore this is to be deemed as if the Austrian company itself has carried out the work in Denmark or through a subcontractor acting under its supervision, control and direction. And accordingly, it came to a conclusion that the Austrian company would have a PE in Denmark. While holding so, the Danish board referred to OECD committee, specifically para 19 of Article 5, wherein the OECD has observed that in the case of subcontract of a contract, in the case of a contract being subcontracted to somebody else, while computing the number of days presence of the contractor, one will also have to take into account the presence of the personnel of subcontractor. It further looked at the recommendations of the OECD's Committee on Fiscal Affairs, wherein the committee recommended to the OECD to specifically modify the commentary to incorporate the point that a foreign company performing business in another country through a subcontractor can create a PE if the conditions of Article 5 are fulfilled. So relying on all these things, the Danish board held that the Austrian company did have a PE in Denmark. Now let's discuss and debate this conclusion arrived at by the Danish board. How do we look at this? the elements of fixed place be when we discuss the Formula One decision? One of the most important criteria is whether the fixed place or business is available at the disposal of the foreign enterprise. In this case, while in terms of the contract, yes, the place was subject was being made available by the Danish company to the Austrian company. The matter of fact is not a single person of the Austrian company was ever supposed to travel to Denmark. And therefore, we only look at the clause of the contract to come to a conclusion that there is a place of business available at the disposal of the Austrian company, or do we look at the actual presence of the Austrian company in Denmark? Are we supposed to look at the actual presence or only a right to a place being available at its disposal to come to a conclusion there is a P? Perhaps one could argue very well that it is the actual or the de facto presence which is relevant and not merely having a right to some premises. I don't have a right to anything in the world, but have I actually traveled to Denmark? Have I actually carried out any activity in Denmark? If not, there is room to argue that a fixed place P should not emerge. There is one more point here. Can this place of business at all be said to be at the disposal of the Austrian company? What do we mean by place of disposal? Assume a case that the work was not subcontracted to a subcontractor and the Austrian company itself carried out this work. But can we say that these premises are at the disposal of Austrian company? What do we mean by the expression place available at disposal? The way I would look at it is to say, I should not only have some access to those premises, I should have complete control over those premises. I should have a right to do what activity I want to do in those premises. Just because somebody else allows me access to those premises to undertake some activity on behalf of that person, that does not mean that I have a place available at my disposal. And this view has been taken in a German case where on identical facts, the German court took a view that where an overseas entity was to provide servicing of premises in Germany, because that this place cannot be said to be at the disposal of the service provider and therefore cannot be in the fixed place fee.
Even if that place might be at my disposal, can you still satisfy the test of carrying on the business through that fixed place? I am not carrying on the business.
Absolutely. That's one more argument. Absolutely.
Then somebody else has carried on in my
on the answer.
So that's also satisfactory.
But before we come to conclusion, let's look at also some of the Indian cases on this. So we have a landmark judgment of the Andhra Pradesh High Court in the case of Visakhapatnam Port Trust. Let's see what the court has held there. This was a case where the assessee entered into a contract with a German company for purchase of plant. The plant was to be assembled and erected by the Indian company itself, which is Visakhapatnam Port Trust, but under the supervision of an engineer which was to be sent by the German company to India. And the German company under the contract was authorized to employ a subcontractor for carrying out certain work which was in the nature of fabrication of a steel sheet, which steel sheet was to be embedded into the machinery supplied by the German company to the assessee. In this case, in this case, the question before the High Court was whether the German company can be said to have fixed place in India or not. And I quote, categorically observed that if you look at the contract between the German company and the subcontractor, the contract is in the nature of a principal-to-principal contract. The subcontractor is not acting as an agent of the German company. In the absence of the subcontractor acting as an agent of the German company, the presence of the subcontractor at the contract site cannot be taken into account while determining whether the German company is a PE or not. And as you all know, this case is relied upon time and again in a variety of cases. One of the landmark decisions on the aspect of fixed place fee is, and in this case has been made for time and again in various cases. Not only has the Andhra Pradesh High Court held it to be so, we have one more decision of the Calcutta Tribunal in the case of HIIT Holland Institute when a similar view has been taken. Of course, the observations of the OECD and especially the recommendations of the Fiscal Committee do seem to go against us. For the matter of fact, is still those recommendations are actually adopted in the committee. As things stand today, it is quite arguable that the presence of subcontractor need not be taken into account while determining the presence of the main contractor. And again, there is one more important point. The observations in para 19 of the OECD committee say that the presence of the subcontractor has to be included in the presence of the contractor. They're in the context of construction B, the ideal 5G. They are not in the context of express B. And again, therefore, can somebody distinguish the observations from these guys? Okay, let's look at one more interesting decision of the Danish tax board involving the case of a German company. So in this case, the German company which was engaged in the business of selling certain technical equipment in Denmark. And for the purpose of sale of the equipment, it employed a sales representative in Denmark. If you look at the activities of the sales representative, it involved basically searching on the internet information about the customers from his home. So he was supposed to work from his home and search on the internet information about potential customers. The sales representative was thereafter supposed to visit offices of the customers and present information about the German company's products to them. And he was also supposed to make standard offers to the customers based on the price as was determined by the German company. But very clearly, as per the contract, the sales representative did not possess the authority to negotiate contract with the customers. And again, here the question was whether the fact that the sales representative was working from a fixed place of business, which was his home, the home was also a place of his business. Doing a sales activity from his home, can it result in a fixed place fee of the German company in Denmark? That was the question before the Danish tax board. Again, here the Danish tax board came to a conclusion that the German company did have a fee in Denmark, since the sales representative performed business of the German company from his home office. What we mean by home office is office operations carried out from his home, therefore home is an office. And therefore, that the German company had fee in Denmark because the business of the German company was carried out by the sales representative from his home office. Again, this decision, you know, throws up multiple questions. Again, the point, can the home of the sales representative be said to be in the disposal of the German company? Can the German company at any stage enter the home of the sales representative and carry out the business operations of its own? The place is at the disposal, not of the sales representative, because it is his own home, but it is not available at the disposal of the German company. Just because some business activity may be carried out from his home, it is not sufficient for the German company to be held to have a PE in Denmark, unless the German company has those premises available at its disposal. Now, this aspect has not been negative in this decision at all. One more point. What was the activity being done at the home? It was only collecting information about potential customers. The balance activities were carried out at the customer's premises. So if the home was deemed to be a PE, the mere activity which was done at the home was collecting information. And can collecting information be said to be a business generating activity, or would it rather fall under the preparatory and auxiliary activity clause, and therefore get outside the definition of PE? That is also an aspect which has not been discussed or debated in this decision. So on these two counts, it is very much arguable that in the facts of this case, a PE ought not to arise in Denmark. And a similar view, in fact, has been taken by the Canadian Supreme Court in the case of Sunbeam Corporation. There are very, very similar facts. The Canadian Supreme Court came to conclude that there is no PE of the overseas entity in Canada. So in this case also, there was a sales representative in Canada acting from his home office. And what are the activities which he carried out? They were responsible for, you know, carrying out the paperwork pertaining to sales operations. He was also receiving some orders for the overseas entity at his home office. And he was also providing demonstration of products from his home to customers. So in fact, here the activities are much larger as compared to the activity in the Danish case. And despite that, the Supreme Court held that the home of the sales representative is not available at the disposal of this company, this Sunbeam. And therefore, in the absence of the home being available at the disposal, the fixed place fee criteria is not fulfilled in Canada, in the fixed place fee of Sunbeam in Canada. So these were two interesting decisions of foreign courts from the aspect of pain. Having had a significant discussion so far on what results in a pain, what does not result in a pain, let's spend a few minutes on the next important aspect, which is profit attribution to pain. You know, while it is one thing to hold that an overseas enterprise is a pain in India, the next thing is how to determine the profits attributable to pain. Now, by and large, if you see all the case laws on profit attribution so far, which I have summarized in the next slide, generally speaking, if you see, courts have gone by a thumb rule to say that if a foreign entity has a pain in India, so let's say somebody from overseas comes to India and signs a contract in India, okay, 10% of the profits are attributable to pain in India. Or if somebody carries out sales operation in India, okay, 25% of the profits are attributable to India. If somebody carries out this activity, then X percent is attributable to India. So courts have by and large just gone by thumb rule, without doing any systematic or scientific analysis. Neither has the assessee done any scientific or systematic analysis, nor has the assessing officer done such an analysis, nor has any appellate authority ever done such an analysis to come to a conclusion as to what would be the profit attributable to the pain. However, there is one recent decision of the tribunal in the case of Aero Electronics, which you look at that in section 1, where the officer went about and did a very, very systematic and scientific analysis for arriving at the profit attribution of the pain, and which was upheld by the tribunal in that case. So basically what I have depicted in this slide is there are a series of case laws starting from SAT, Satellite, DBC, etc. where 0% profits were held to be attributable to the pain in India because an arm's length remuneration was to be paid to the agent on one end of the spectrum. And on the other end of the spectrum, we have the case of the Chennai High Court in the case of Ansaldo SPA, where in the context of supply of equipment and installation activity, etc., 75% of the profits were held to be attributable. But let's look at the case of Aero, which seems to be setting altogether new trend on profit attribution to pain. In this case, we have Aero Singapore, which had a liaison officer sales or a representative office in India, and initially filed a nil return for the Aero in India. However, the assessing officer carried out a survey on the premises of the liaison office and came to a conclusion. There were various marketing and sales operations which were carried out by the Aero, and therefore the officer held that the liaison office had a pain in India, and it called upon the liaison office to file a tax return once again. Also to the survey, once again called upon the assessee to file a tax return in India. And in this, the second time when the assessee filed a tax return, it offered its income to tax on the basis of a cost plus markup. So it said, here are all the costs of the Aero. It added a 6% markup to that to say that this is a profit attributable to the Aero. And without explicitly or directly admitting to OP, the fact that income was offered to tax means implicitly it accepted that the Aero was a pain, and that is why it offered the income to tax in India. The Aero disregarded the basis of profit attribution to the P, and thereafter went about conducting in a very systematic and scientific manner the profit attribution exercise. What did the AO? So AO said, once you conduct a functional asset and risk analysis of the P for determining the profit attribution to P, the AO said that I'll give 50% weightage to the functions carried out in India, 25% weightage to assets, and further 25% weightage to risks. Out of the 50% weightage given to functions, the AO said that 70% of the functions were carried out by the LO in India and 30% of the functions were carried out by the HO, head office in Singapore. And therefore it said 70% of 50% is 35% becomes attributable to India, 15% becomes attributable to Singapore. On the assets, it said LO has 10% of the assets, head office has 90% of the assets. So 10% of 25%, 2.5% attributable to India. Balance 22.5% attributable to Singapore. Similarly, on risk, and therefore if you add up 35 plus 2.5 plus 2.5, he said that 40% of the profits therefore become attributable to India, and 60% of the profits attributable to the functions, assets, and risk paid out in Singapore. And having done such a scientific and detailed analysis, the assessee could not convince the tribunal as to why was this methodology incorrect, and could not come up with a more urgent manner of doing the profit attribution. The tribunal therefore accepted the profit attribution done by the assessing officer in this case to be 40% of profits of the Singapore business would be attributable to lease and office in India, and therefore the taxable in India. And what is very, very imperative going forward, wherever we advise clients on whether there is a PE in India or not, is also important to carry out that further round of analysis. But assuming if there was to be a PE in India, let's do a profit attribution analysis, a detailed and systematic analysis which can be presented to the officer and which can be used as an evidence before appellate forum to say that I as an SSCI myself done a detailed analysis, and therefore then it becomes difficult for the assessing officer to revolve our analysis rather than solely relying upon something on the officer in business case. Any case of doing a far analysis for determining profit attribution. There are, okay, so while there may be principles, international business, but we do have the OECD's detailed paper on profit attribution to be. We also have detailed guidelines of the Australian tax office on profit attribution to be. So the officer seems to have sort of taken some guidance, it seems, from the OECD paper on the Australian tax office.
The challenge in all these cases is that the expenses by the foreign company. So, I mean, this scenario, okay, the EO says that 40% of the profits are attributable. But point is that whatever payments which a foreign company makes in India, generally they don't deduct TDS. In which case, then they may end up at a situation where they may have to pay even 42% from
the profits. True, you're right. So, if there are any payments incurred which may be liable tax in India, there's always a risk of a discount number 41. And therefore, virtually the gross amount of
money. Generally, this is a challenge.
Agree, fair point. True. Let us now come to the last decision of today's presentation, and that is the decision of the Bombay High Court in the case of JSH Mauritius involving the evergreen topic of Indian Mauritius treaty. So, in this case, the associate Mauritian company had a GBL1 license in Mauritius and was engaged in the business of investment and financing activities. It had a tax residency certificate which it had obtained from the Mauritian authorities to avail the benefits of the Indian Mauritius Treaty. The associate invested in the shares of Tata Industries in 1996. These shares were held for a period of 13 years before which the shares were sold to Tata Sons in 2009. And the sale proceeds were further invested in some other Tata Group company. Proceeding the taxability of the capital gain arising from this transaction, the SSE filed an application to the AR. And the AR, relying on Article 13 of the Indian Mauritius Treaty and also offered in the Chamandalam, etc., came to a conclusion that the capital gain is exempt from tax in India. The revenue not being happy with the decision of the AR filed a writ petition to the Bombay High Court and made a plea before the Bombay High Court that the benefit of capital gains article should not be allowed to the SSE in this case. And what were the reasons or the justification for making this submission to the High Court? The remedy contended that the SSE was a shell company or what we call as a fly-by-night company in Mauritius. And what is the basis for that allegation? The remedy mentioned that if you look at the original FIPB application which was made by the SSE, that application was made by Jardine Bermuda, and at a later stage, the Mauritian entity was interposed into the structure and substituted in place of Bermuda. So it was a case of an afterthought by the SSE, only with a view to take the benefits of India-Mauritius Treaty, that they interposed the Mauritian entity in the structure. And if you remember, this was one of the key reasons why the Bombay High Court itself, in the earlier case of AT&T, then AT&T, held against the SSE and denied the benefits of the India-Mauritius Treaty. So this was an allegation made by the remedy. Thereafter, the revenue argued that the SSE never nominated anybody on the board of Tata Industries, and it was the other group companies of the SSE which nominated people on the board, and therefore the SSE had no control or no say in the operations of the Indian entity whatsoever, and no active role was placed by the SSE. It also observed that there were no expenses incurred by the SSE in Mauritius in terms of office, premises, electricity, salary, director's pension, nothing, zero expenses. So it said this is nothing but a case of a shell company, and therefore, on all these counts which I referred to earlier, the revenue alleged that the entity is a shell company not having any business substance at all in Mauritius, and this is so therefore this is a classic case of treaty abuse or treaty shopping, and therefore the benefits of the Indian Mauritius treaty should be denied to the system. High Court, after examining the ruling of the AR and relying on the classic decision in the case of Supreme Court, in the case of Azadi Bachao, came to a conclusion that the benefit of Indian Motion Security should be granted to the CC for the simple reason that, as we all know, the Supreme Court in Azadi Bachao is held for claiming the benefits under Indian Motion Security. The only condition to be fulfilled by the Mauritian entity is to obtain a tax residency certificate from Mauritius. And once a TRC is obtained, it is binding on the Indian revenue and it is deemed to be a resident of Mauritius, and the Indian revenue cannot go behind the TRC. Solely relying on that observation of the Supreme Court, the AR held in favor of the SSC, and so did the Bombay High Court ruled that having regard to this fact, the benefit of capital gains exemption is to be granted. The High Court went one step further to say that this company is not a fly-by-night or shell company, for the simple reason that these shares were held for a long period of 13 years. So it is an entity which held the shares for a longish period of time, and therefore this was a bona fide activity it carried out. And further, the sale proceeds were once again invested in another Tata Group company, which shows that this is not a shell company or a fly-by-night company, and therefore it eventually granted the benefit of capital gains altogether. The revenue also taken an alternate way to say that this income would be taxable under section 911 gag with explanation 5. You know, even for a moment, if we were to presume that the treaty benefits are not available, I fail to understand why would 911 with explanation 5 be available. So this was a case of direct transfer of shares by a Mauritian entity of an Indian entity. This is not a case of indirect transfer. 911 comes into picture if there is an indirect transfer. If the owners of the Mauritian entity get transferred Mauritius, then 911 could come into play. But this is a case of direct transfer. But the court rejected our argument on the ground that in any case treaty benefit is available in this case and that the SSC is eligible for the treaty exemption. And therefore, in that form itself, the benefit is available. And finally, held that the SSC, therefore, is not liable to pay capital gains tax anymore. And we all know what has happened with the India Mauritius Treaty over the last few months or so. And all these cases of shell companies, etc., will be history going forward. So, with this, I come to an end to my presentation. Thank you so much for the invitation.
I will request Raya Shah, convener, to propose our vote of thanks.
Dear seniors and friends, we've had an enriching session from Hema Chubai, taking us discussing the insights from the case law. Thank you very much for giving your time and giving your insights. Please join me in the next one. Thank you.